From New York, this is Democracy Now!
If you put your hands up, they shoot. If you put your hands down, they shoot. If you walk, you run, you hide, you sleep, you do exactly as they say, they still shoot.
Thousands protest in Chicago over the police killing of 13-year-old Adam Toledo, who was shot dead with his hands in the air. We'll go to Chicago to speak with a community organizer and journalist, and with Rutgers professor Lilia Fernandez, author of the book Brown in the Windy City, Mexicans and Puerto Ricans in Postwar Chicago. Then a lieutenant in the Army Medical Corps, Karan Nazario, is suing two Virginia police officers who pepper sprayed him, pushed him to the ground, and pointed their guns at him during a traffic stop at a Virginia gas station.
I'm actively serving this country, and this is how you're gonna treat me? I didn't do anything. Whoa, hold on. What's going on? Hold on.
Air Force is deployed.
We'll speak to Lieutenant Nazario's lawyer. Then a New York court has vindicated an African-American Buffalo police officer who was punched in the face, then fired and stripped of her pension for stopping a white cop from choking a handcuffed black man during a 2006 arrest. The former officer, Carol Horn, will join us.
I hear the problems all of the time, so I wanted a solution. And what will force the officers to do it? Because if you don't force them, a lot of them are still not going to do it because they don't want to cross over that blue line.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. A Minneapolis jury is hearing closing arguments today in the murder trial of former police officer Derek Chauvin, who killed George Floyd last May by kneeling on his neck for over 9 minutes. Jurors will be sequestered until they reach a unanimous verdict. Democracy Now! Will be airing the closing arguments at 10 Eastern today. This comes as demonstrations continued over the weekend in the Minneapolis suburb of Brooklyn Center over the police killing of 20-year-old Dante Wright. On Friday, police arrested over 100 people at protests. Officers also rounded up journalists, forced them onto their stomachs, and photographed their faces and press credentials. Others were shot with chemical sprays and other so-called less lethal weapons. CNN producer Carolyn Sung was thrown to the ground, zip-tied, and arrested by a trooper who yelled, "Do you speak English?" even though she repeatedly identified herself as a journalist. Sung is Asian American. The Minneapolis protests came as the New York Times reported more than three people a day have died at the hands of law enforcement since Derek Chauvin's trial began. Meanwhile, Attorney General Merrick Garland has reversed a Trump-era Justice Department rule limiting the use of federal consent decrees to address abuses by local police departments. Protests are also continuing in Chicago over the police killing of 13-year-old Adam Toledo, a Latinx boy. Police body cam video shows Adam had his hands up in the air when he was shot dead by an officer in March. On Sunday, thousands marched in the largely Mexican neighborhood of Little Village, where Adam was killed. James Murphy, a longtime prosecutor in Cook County, has been placed on administrative leave after he falsely told a judge that Toledo was holding a gun when police shot him. We'll have the latest on these stories after headlines. Florida Republican Governor Ron DeSantis is set to sign the state's so-called anti-riot bill that was pushed by Republicans in the wake of last summer's Black Lives Matter uprising. Among other things, it bars local governments from cutting police budgets without state approval and raises penalties on demonstrators accused of a crime, including damage to historical monuments or statues. The eight victims of last week's mass shooting at an Indianapolis FedEx facility have been identified. They are Matthew Alexander, Samaria Blackwell, Amarjeet Johal, Jasvinder Singh, Amarjeet Sekhan, Jasvinder Kaur, Carly Smith, and John Weissert. Four of the victims are members of the local Sikh community. Meanwhile, the Indianapolis police revealed Brandon Hole, the 19-year-old white mass murderer and former FedEx employee, legally purchased the two semi-automatic rifles used in the attack. They were bought just a few months after police seized a shotgun from Hole after his mother brought forward concerns about his mental state. At least two other mass shootings took place in the U.S. over the weekend. In Kenosha, Wisconsin, three men were shot dead Sunday at a college bar. Three others were hospitalized. In Texas, another three people were killed Sunday in a shooting in Austin. A former deputy with the Travis County Sheriff's Office, Stephen Nicholas Broderick, has been named a suspect. The world has topped 3 million reported deaths from COVID-19, with infections rising across parts of Asia, Latin America, and Europe. On Friday, the head of the World Health Organization warned the pandemic could soon be entering its worst phase yet.
Globally, the number of new cases per week has nearly doubled over the past 2 months. This is approaching the highest rate of infection that we have seen so far during the pandemic.
In Brazil, hospitals remain stretched to their limit as deaths average 3,000 per day. A new study estimated over 2,000 children under 9 have died of COVID-19 in Brazil, over half of those babies since the pandemic started. India recorded yet another new record of over 273,000 cases Monday. This is surgeon at a Delhi hospital.
There are no beds in the ICUs. There are no ventilators. There are no medicines are in short supply. Even oxygen is in short supply in more and more states. And those who have died are waiting for hours together for a decent cremation. What can be more dangerous and more frightening than this scenario?
While many countries have yet to inoculate even their most vulnerable, some wealthier nations are moving towards a return to normal life after successful vaccination programs. Israel's lifted its outdoor mask mandate and fully reopened schools, but Israel's medical apartheid has left the majority of Palestinians out of the region's recovery. Here in the U.S., half the adult population has received at least one dose of a coronavirus vaccine. A quarter of adults are fully vaccinated. The U.S. continues to average more than 67,000 new infections a day. A Centers for Disease Control panel will meet Friday to issue recommendations on whether to resume use of Johnson & Johnson's COVID vaccine. The U.S. temporarily halted use of the one-shot vaccine after at least six people reported an extremely rare blood clot disorder out of 7 million. On Friday, seven Johnson & Johnson scientists said there was insufficient evidence of a link between the clots and the vaccine. Dr. Anthony Fauci said over the weekend he expects the U.S. will resume its use.
My estimate is that we will continue to use it in some form. I doubt very seriously if they just cancel it. I don't think that's going to happen.
South Africa's health regulator has recommended resuming Johnson & Johnson vaccines after also halting its rollout. Russian prison officials transferred opposition leader, nationalist politician Alexei Navalny to a hospital 3 weeks after he began a hunger strike to protest a lack of medical care while in prison. His doctor says his kidneys are deteriorating and he's at high risk of cardiac arrest. Navalny's serving a 3.5-year sentence over what his supporters say are trumped-up charges. Over the weekend, U.S. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan warned Russia over Navalny's treatment, saying there would be consequences if Navalny dies. Russia's foreign ministry has expelled 10 U.S. diplomats and will bar top U.S. officials from traveling to Russia after President Biden ordered sweeping new sanctions against Russia. The White House accuses Russia of interfering in the 2020 election and says Russian hackers are behind the massive SolarWinds hack, which compromised the computer systems of U.S. government agencies and scores of private companies. In Bangladesh, five people were killed and dozens more wounded Saturday after police opened fire on a crowd of 2,000 workers protesting unpaid wages and demanding better working conditions. The violent crackdown came at a Chinese-owned coal-fired power plant southeast of the capital, Dhaka. Syria's parliament has announced plans to hold a presidential election May 26th.
I call on Syrian citizens inside and outside the country to practice their right in electing the president of the republic.
Candidates must have lived in Syria for the past decade, leading exiled opposition politicians to condemn the election as a farce. The vote is widely expected to return President Bashar al-Assad to a third term. This comes on the 10th anniversary of Assad's violent crackdown on anti-government protesters, which sparked a civil war that has displaced millions and left more than 380,000 dead. President Biden walked back his decision to keep the Trump-era cap on the number of refugees admitted to the U.S. after intense backlash from some Democrats and rights groups. The current annual limit is just 15,000, a record low. Biden now says he'll announce the increased number for this fiscal year by May 15th. North Carolina police arrested two men over the shooting deaths of two black transgender women. The women have been identified as Jada Peterson and Remy Fennell. They are believed to be at least the 14th and 15th transgender or gender nonconforming people to be violently killed this year. Meanwhile, states continue to push laws threatening the lives and safety of trans people around the country. Another bill that would bar trans athletes and student sports teams is currently making its way through the Florida legislature. And in Texas, 10-year-old trans activist Kai Shapley addressed state lawmakers last week to speak out against two bills criminalizing gender-affirming health care for trans youth.
Texas legislators have been attacking me since pre-K. I am in fourth grade now. When it comes to bills that target trans youth, I immediately feel angry. It's been very scary and overwhelming. It makes me sad that some politicians use trans kids like me to get votes from people who hate me just because I exist.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Protests are continuing in Chicago over the police killing of 13-year-old Adam Toledo. Police body cam video released Thursday shows Adam had his empty hands up in the air when he was shot by an officer on March 29th. Adam was a seventh grader at Gary Elementary School. The Chicago police initially described the incident as an armed confrontation, but the video shows Adam raised his hands after being ordered to do so after a short chase. Police were investigating reports of gunfire in the area. Amid nationwide protests over his killing, thousands marched Sunday in Chicago's Little Village, the largely Mexican neighborhood where Adam was killed. 2 days earlier, on Friday, thousands gathered in Chicago's Logan Square. Some held signs reading, quote, "My hands are up, don't shoot." Protesters blasted authorities for trying to cover up the circumstances of Adam's death. Meanwhile, James Murphy, a longtime prosecutor in Cook County, has been placed on administrative leave after he falsely told a judge that Toledo was holding a gun when police shot him. In a statement, Cook County State's Attorney Kim Fox's office said Murphy had, quote, failed to fully present the facts surrounding the death of a 13-year-old boy. Over the weekend, Democratic state lawmaker Edgar Gonzalez Jr. criticized the police for being too willing to shoot.
If you put your hands up, they shoot. If you put your hands down, they shoot. If you walk, you run, you hide, you sleep, you do exactly as they say, they still shoot.
We're joined now by two guests. Lilia Fernandez is a native Chicagoan, associate professor of Latino and Caribbean Studies and History at Rutgers University. She's the author of the book Brown in the Windy City, Mexicans and Puerto Ricans in Postwar Chicago, is currently writing a new book titled A History of Latino Chicago, Class Solidarities and Coalitional Politics. And Lilia is married to Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez. In Chicago, we're joined by Mateo Zapata, an independent journalist, photographer, and community organizer. He recently wrote an op-ed for the Chicago Tribune titled, We Are Adam. For many youth across Chicago's South and West Sides, Adam Toledo's life trajectory is too familiar. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Mateo, you've been in the streets of Chicago this weekend covering the protests. Talk about the issues being raised and the original circumstances of this 13-year-old boy, Adam Toledo's death.
Good morning. The original circumstances surround the fact that the Chicago Police Department actively tried to cover up everything about this case. And COPPA also tried to delay the release of the footage.
COPPA is?
And COPPA is the police accountability entity in Chicago. So they're responsible for handling all of the evidence and processing everything around people that are murdered by police.
So the murder happened at the end of March, but it took a few weeks for this video to be released. So the police and the city shaped the narrative at the beginning.
Yeah, no, I mean, the pro-police narrative has been in full effect. And, you know, there's been just a lot of demonizing happening in regards to who Adam was and the circumstances of how he was murdered. And, you know, what we've seen in Chicago is just the police department here is developing a culture of killing people during foot pursuits. You know, 3 days after Adam was murdered, they shot and killed Anthony Alvarez, who was also running. And last year, they killed Mark Nevarez in that same neighborhood of Little Village when he was running as well. Within Adam's circumstances and everything surrounding his murder, what we saw is he complied. He had his hands up and they were empty, and he was still murdered. And so, you know, people in Chicago are just tired of seeing black and brown youth murdered by police.
Let me bring Professor Fernandez into this conversation. You've been following this very closely from the beginning, albeit from afar. Talk about what happened when you saw that video at the end, when the police officer says, hold up your hands and turn around. Exactly what Adam did.
Thank you for having me, Amy, and I wish it were under better circumstances. But watching that video was absolutely heart-wrenching. You know, we have been traumatized over and over again, to say nothing of the families of these victims. You know, watching the killing of 12-year-old Tamir Rice, 13-year-old Tyree King, 17-year-old Laquan McDonald, that's who I immediately thought of when I saw this this video footage of Adam Toledo. Young people, innocent teenagers who had no idea that their lives were about to be taken from them by these officers. So it's devastating. It's absolutely devastating. But I will say also that, you know, we have seen a lot of attention to the killings of African Americans recently. Adam Toledo is Mexican American, I believe, and I'm glad that we're finally getting some national attention on police brutality and killings of Latinos. This has been going on for far too long. I can say more about that, about the history of police brutality and police killings of Latinos, not only in Chicago, but in other cities around the country.
Why don't you talk about that now?
Sure. Well, you know, as I said, this is not a new phenomenon. You know, going back even to the 1920s, Mexican immigrants in Chicago complained about the prejudiced treatment that they received from police officers compared to how they treated Polish immigrants, for example. But most of the examples I've looked at are from the 50s and 60s. That's really when the Latino or Latinx population began to grow in Chicago with the influx of Mexican-Americans, Mexican immigrants, and Puerto Ricans. And many Chicago residents and police did not like this, the fact that these populations were moving in and moving into some predominantly white neighborhoods. Ever since then, we've seen countless examples of different kinds of police brutality and abuse. Even the famed oral historian Studs Terkel documented a Puerto Rican man, Carlos Alvarez, reporting that police fractured his arm when he was coming off of his night shift as a watchman at a museum. other men like Celestino Gonzalez and Silvano Burgos, this is all in the 1960s, by the way, gave accounts of brutal police beatings in police station in station in 1965. The shooting of 20-year-old Arcelis Cruz, a Puerto Rican youth in the Humboldt Park neighborhood in June of 1966, is what set off the Division Street uprising that year. And the rest of that summer, there were a number of other shootings and beatings of Latino men. 15-year-old Nelson Rivera, who was shot and killed in Woodlawn, the Woodlawn neighborhood, for stealing a car. Ismael Laboy, who was killed by police in front of his wife and eight children. And the list goes on and on. What's clear is that over the decades, the different calls from activists and community leaders for reforms have not changed this problem. This is an intractable issue, and I think we need to understand the deep origins of it to really affect the kind of reform or systemic changes that are needed.
The Toledo family's attorney, Adina Weiss-Ortiz, described the killing as an assassination during a press conference last week. This is what she said.
By now, all of you have seen the videos of Adam Toledo. They are especially moving, saddening, distressful to see a 13-year-old boy shot at the hands of an officer. For those of you with children, you can relate to some of the pain that the Toledos are feeling today. Those videos speak for themselves. Adam, during his last second of life, did not have a gun in his hand. The officer screamed at him, "Show me your hands." Adam complied, turned around. His hands were empty when he was shot in the chest at the hands of the officer. He did not have a gun in his hand, contrary to the reports made earlier today.
That's the Toledo family attorney, Adina Weiss-Ortiz, speaking last week about the killing of Adam, 13-year-old seventh grader at Gary Elementary School. Mateo Zapata, you've been writing about Adam's story. Can you tell us about where he grew up, about his school, about how he was separated from other students and more?
Yeah, he grew up on the south side of Chicago in the West Lawn neighborhood. He had barely been in Little Village for about a year, and he was labeled a SPED student early on, but he didn't have any severe learning disabilities at all. But he was still marginalized and separated. So the educators that I spoke with, his former teachers, said that they didn't feel that he really had the opportunity to develop his social and emotional intelligence. And I think that's a situation that a lot of youth in Chicago's public school system deal with. Even myself, I was kicked out of school when I was younger as well. And I think that Adam, having been so young, still had an opportunity to have some of whatever was going on be addressed, but it wasn't. And I think that the Chicago public school system needs to have a serious moment of reflection on how it treats its inner city students.
You spoke to several of Adam's teachers, and as we speak, Mateo, you are a video journalist, and we've been running some of the video of the protests over the weekend that you took. Tell us what his teachers said.
The teachers said that, you know, he was really passionate about art. He really liked to draw a lot. That was like his gift. That was his thing, you know, and the teacher felt that if there was the resources or the programming to explore arts education, that that could have been a means for Adam to utilize his energy in a more constructive manner. Specifically in Little Village, throughout the last two decades, it's been studied as being one of the areas in Chicago that has the largest group of what's called disconnected youth. So it's groups of young people that live in these neighborhoods that aren't enrolled in any sort of academic institution and are also unemployed.
So, Professor Fernandez, talk about the narrative before we saw the video, because people might be surprised to see that Adam was killed by the police at the end of March, that the uprising is just happening now. But that's because the video footage wasn't released. And at this point, even an attorney within the city has been suspended for misrepresenting what was in that video before we saw it, saying that Adam had a gun in his hand.
That's right. Chicago police and Assistant State's Attorney James Murphy knew for more than 2 weeks that this police shooting looked dreadful. And so they began to craft a narrative to justify it, claiming that this was first an armed confrontation, quote unquote, that Toledo was holding a gun when he was shot. They kept emphasizing the shot spotter technology, which saturates poor Black and brown communities in Chicago and other kinds of video surveillance and a militarized technology that's supposed to reduce crime. And they also noted in an editorial, the Chicago Tribune, in an editorial recently, tried to make the connection to Robin Roman's, somehow implicating him that he was ultimately responsible for Toledo's death.
And explain who he was, the 21-year-old.
Yes, Ruben Roman was the 21-year-old who was allegedly in Toledo's company and who presumably was the owner of the gun that police claim was being fired and that they claim Toledo had in his possession. However, we know that these kinds of narratives that the police and state's attorneys' offices craft, you know, they're always the same. They're always depicting victims of police violence as the bad guy, either the bad guys, the criminals, or simply collateral damage in police pursuit of the bad guys. Black and Latino communities do not commit any more crimes than white Americans do. And yet, it's precisely those neighborhoods that are over-policed, and it's precisely the crime that occurs in those neighborhoods that we focus on. We have to ask ourselves as a society, why don't we look more carefully or think more about other kinds of crimes that are committed, that happen every day in this country? Corporate crimes, companies that pollute and are destroying our environment and our communities, political leaders who commit fraud and embezzlement and you know, rob public coffers of millions of dollars, people who distribute child pornography. None of that crime ever comes into the conversation. Instead, what we always focus on is drugs and violent crime in poor working class communities where many residents who are not able to find employment in the regular labor market go into the informal economy. You know, lastly, I'll say that Adam Toledo would not be dead today if he were white, if he were from an affluent family, or if he lived in a predominantly white neighborhood.
And finally, Mateo, on Sunday morning, the mayor, Lightfoot, posted a series of tweets to her personal Twitter account addressing unsubstantiated rumors that she would resign as Chicago mayor on that was Sunday morning. Your thoughts?
Lori Lightfoot is a liar, and she's a cop. And she has been extremely oppressive towards Black and brown communities since she got into office. If you remember the video of the police raid on Anjanette Young's house, she tried to suppress that body cam footage to come out. So she is not in any way or position someone who should ever speak on behalf of Black or brown communities in Chicago. She gave over half of our federal COVID relief funds to the Chicago Police Department. That's over $280 million that she gave to CPD as our federal COVID relief that we should have had in Black and brown communities that were the most impacted during the pandemic, the people that had the highest death rates, contraction rates, the essential workers in this city. They are predominantly in Black and brown communities. So that's where the COVID relief funding needed to be. So Lori Lightfoot, she definitely needs to resign, and she should no longer be the mayor of Chicago.
Lori Lightfoot, before she was mayor, was president of the Chicago Police Board and chair of the Chicago Police Accountability Task Force. Where do you see these protests going, Mateo?
I think that the protests will likely continue. I think that aside from the marching, aside from the protests, I think we really need to look at instituting some kind of policy in regards to foot pursuits in Chicago specifically. Right now, there is no policy. And that's something that I already know a few people around the South Side that have worked at raising awareness on how police terrorize our communities. We're starting to seriously consider the need to institute some sort of foot pursuit policy, because we cannot continue to allow the Chicago Police Department to kill Black and brown people in our communities when they are running away.
And is there any discussion, any word about the charging of the police officer who killed Adam?
No, as of now, I have not heard of any charges being brought up on Officer Eric Stillman, who murdered Adam Toledo with his hands up while he was unarmed.
Final word, right, Professor now. Fernandez.
Yes, I think that we need to look very seriously at the long history of this intractable problem. You know, in the 50s and 60s, when the community complained about police abuse and violence, they said it was a language barrier issue, and so they sent cops to learn Spanish. In the 70s, they said, we don't have enough Hispanic police on the force, and so they started to demand hiring of more Latino officers. In the 80s and 90s, of course, we talked more about accountability than the body cameras. Now we have these body cameras and all this technology, and still the police culture of disdain and even contempt for brown people, for Black people, for non-white people, and particularly for poor people, continues to permeate both law enforcement and the criminal justice system. So this requires a complete overhaul, and we need to think big. We need to work in solidarity with one another, understand that, as the recent violence against Asian Americans has shown, that racism, that we have a problem beyond anti-Black racism, but also racism against brown people, Asian Americans, and others.
Lilia Fernandez, I want to thank you for being with us. Rutgers University professor, native Chicagoan, author of Brown in the Windy City, Mexicans and Puerto Ricans in Postwar Chicago, writing a second book titled A History of Latino Chicago, Class Solidarities and Coalitional Politics. And thanks so much to Mateo Zapata, independent journalist, photographer and community organizer. We'll link to both of your books, your articles, at democracynow.org. Next up, a lieutenant in the Army Medical Corps is suing two Virginia police officers who pepper sprayed him, pushed him to the ground, pointed their guns at his head during a traffic stop. We'll speak with his lawyer. Stay with us. Sophisticated Lady by the Charles Mingus Sextet and Eric Dolphy. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. A warning to our audience, the following story contains graphic descriptions and images of police violence. We now turn to Virginia, where a lieutenant in the Army Medical Corps is suing two police officers who pepper-sprayed him, pushed him to the ground, pointed their guns at him during a traffic stop at a gas station last December. Lieutenant Karan Nazario, who is a Black Latinx man, was wearing his Army uniform at the time. Nazario says he drove to the gas station to avoid pulling over in a dark road after he noticed a police car flashing its lights at him so that he could be somewhere public and well-lit while he interacted with them. Video of the attack in the town of Windsor, Virginia, has sparked outrage.
Keep your hands outside the window.
My hands are right here. What's going on?
Get out of the car now.
Get out of the car.
What's
now.
Going on?
Get out of the car now. Get out of the car now.
I'm serving this country and this is how I'm treated.
Yo, what? Guess what? I'm a veteran too. I'm going to obey. That's Get out of the car.
What's going on?
Get out of the car now.
What's going on?
What's going on? You're fixing to ride the lightning, son.
I'm sorry, what?
Now.
What's going
get out
on?
Of the car now. Get out of the car.
Sir, just get out of the car. Work with us and we'll talk to you. Get out the car.
You received our order. Obey it.
I'm honestly afraid to get out. Can I?
Yeah, you should be. Get out.
What's going on? What did I do?
Get out now.
I have not committed any crimes.
You're being stopped for a traffic violation. You're not cooperating at this point right now. You're under arrest.
For a traffic.
You're being detained, okay? You're being detained for
a traffic violation. I do not have to get out the vehicle. You haven't even told me why I'm being stopped.
Really?
Get your hands.
Get out of the car now. Get out of the car.
Get your hands off me, please. Get your hands off me.
You know what?
Get your hands off me. Get your hands off me. Me.
Back up,
I didn't do anything. Don't do that.
Sir,
get out of the car.
Don't
now.
Do that.
Hey, sir,
don't
get out of the car now.
Don't do that. I'm trying to talk to you.
Okay.
I'm trying to talk to you.
Get out.
Just
relax.
Get out
of the car.
Can you please relax? Can
get
you
out.
Please relax?
Get out of the car right now. Now.
This is not how you treat a vet. I'm actively serving this country, and this is how you're going to treat me? I didn't do anything. Whoa, hold on. Okay. What's going on? Hold on. Watch it. Watch it.
Air Force is deployed.
Get out of the car! Get out of the car now!
That's up.
Get out of the car now!
Sir, just get out of the car!
I'm trying to breathe. Ugh.
Get out of the car now!
That's up. That's really up.
Yeah, get out of the car and get on the ground now. You're gonna get it again!
I don't even want to reach my seatbelt.
What our radio audience might not be able to see is he's getting pepper sprayed at point blank range by the officer. Lieutenant Karan Nazario was then forced to the ground and handcuffed. The officer who deployed the pepper spray, Joe Gutierrez, was fired last week, days after the public video of the release of the video was public, but nearly 4 months after the actual incident. Virginia Governor Ralph Northam said he's directing the state police to conduct an investigation. We go now to Richmond, Virginia, where we're joined by Jonathan Arthur, attorney for U.S. Army Second Lieutenant Karan Nazario. Can you explain how this happened? Can you explain why they stopped him? And that terrifying comment that this police officer made as the lieutenant was saying, what did I do wrong? He said, you're fixing to ride the lightning?
It's incredible, isn't it, Amy? And thank you for having me. That in response to a calm, you know, question, hey, what did I do wrong? One of our law enforcement felt it appropriate to threaten a man with, you know, state-sanctioned murder. That particular expression, ride the lightning, is colloquial for, you know, being electrocuted in the electric chair, what Virginia called Old Sparky. And there's an even more grotesque layer to that statement when you take a look at the way that the death penalty has been disproportionately applied to African Americans and people of color in Virginia and in the South. It's a terrifying statement, especially when you're facing the barrel of a gun, and especially because you have been pulled over ostensibly because one of the officers said you didn't have a license plate, which was, in fact, factually false.
In fact, he had just bought this car. Is that right? It had dark tinted windows and the license was in the window.
Yes, the dealer where he purchased the vehicle had placed the temporary tag in the back upper right-hand corner of the rear window. And, you know, one of the maddening things is when you take a look at both of these officers' body-worn cameras, you know, before they're obscured by the officers' firearms, the body-worn cameras picks up the presence of this license plate. The officer that initiated this traffic stop ultimately says, yeah, you know, I saw it when I got out of my video, when I got out of my car, but I was too busy dealing with you. It belies belief.
And you have the lieutenant saying, I'm afraid of police, and he said, you should be?
Yeah. So, you know, after having to deal with these inconsistent commands, right, officers saying, keep your hands out of the window, and other officers saying, you know, get out of the vehicle, and you can't do the same thing. You can't do both of those at the same time. To say, hey, I'm scared to get out of this vehicle, well, a reasonable person should have been like, well, let's see what we can do to de-escalate this situation. But that's precisely the opposite of what the town of Windsor and its police force did. Instead of de-escalating, Joe Gutierrez says, yeah, confirmed, after having threatened to murder my client, that my client should be afraid to get out of the vehicle. That's wholly unacceptable. The man has no business being in law enforcement.
And explain how this actually first went down. You have Lieutenant Nazario seeing the police lights, but afraid to pull over on a dark road. So drive slowly for, what, another minute until he finds a well-lit area, which is a gas station, then pulls over.
That's correct. And, you know, one of the really, really troubling statements in this whole interaction, and there's a few of them we can talk about, is Joe Gutierrez saying, hey, you know, I knew what you were doing. I knew you were pulling over to a well-lit place for officer safety and for my safety and for yours. It happens all the time. And, you know, I think he says 80% of the time it's a minority. And they may inform some of his behaviors that we find so baffling.
Amazingly, the Washington Post reports that Karan Nazario's wife, Raquel, is a cousin of Eric Garner. Eric Garner, of course, the African-American man who was killed by police in 2014, put him in a chokehold, took him down. Video of the rest went viral, as he said 11 times, I can't breathe. Karan Nazario called Garner his uncle.
You know, lightning's not supposed to strike twice, right? In the same location, in the same place. And I think it's a testament to how brutal and how violent our police are. When this type of violence occurs twice to the same family in two different states, hundreds of miles apart, I think it lays bare some of the systemic problems that America is facing with how our police interact with the people they're trying to protect. They're supposed to be protecting.
So, Lieutenant Nazario was wearing his uniform. He even said he was afraid to release his seatbelt because he'd have to reach down, and that could be an excuse for the police.
That's correct. What would have happened, you know, I think he was forced to, which one of those two officers he was going to listen to? Did he keep his hands out of the vehicle so everyone could see it, or did he move them down so he could see, you know, his seatbelt? And luckily, I think he picked the right officer to comply with, to keep the hands out of the window. Because, you know, from looking at how these two officers behaved with their guns pointed at his head, it's not unreasonable to think that had my client tried to comply and taken his seatbelt off, that they would have murdered him right there at the BP in Windsor over a traffic stop.
So you've filed a $1 million lawsuit on behalf of the lieutenant. What are you calling for in addition?
So, you know, there's a couple of, the overriding purpose of this lawsuit is to put a stop to this behavior, however we have to do it. You know, we fight with the tools that we are given. So, you know, my client's looking just to hold these officers accountable under law and, you know, stop this behavior. So we're seeking for the federal court to say, hey, you know, this behavior was illegal. And there's some things that are even, I think, more troubling from a constitutional standpoint than the violence. And that's both of these officers then threatening to destroy my client's career if he speaks out on the issue. So we're trying to get, we're asking the federal court to declare those actions illegal and unconstitutional. We want a jury to say the same thing so we can write this in legal stone and we can use it as further precedent down the road so that others can hold other officers accountable, because they will not stop this behavior unless there is accountability, until there is accountability. And finally, there are the monetary damages. Now, the law says that my client is entitled to be compensated for the damages that he suffered, right? For the attack, for the pepper spray, for the constitutionally shattering actions of these officers. And the law also says that the jury can award exemplary damages. And this is to make an example out of the conduct, to punish the conduct, to keep the conduct from happening again. And if we can't get these law enforcement officers to change on their own, then another way to do it is to make it so expensive for these municipalities moving forward to continue operating as they are that will bankrupt them or force them to change their behavior.
Well,
so everything we're doing here is
Jonathan Arthur. I want to thank you for being with us, attorney for U.S. Army Second Lieutenant Caron Nazario, who I should say was in his uniform. He has sued two Virginia police officers, pepper sprayed him, pushed him to the ground, pointed their guns at him, threatened him during a traffic stop in December. Next up, a New York court vindicates an African-American Buffalo police officer who was punched in the face, then fired and stripped of her pension for trying to stop a white cop from choking a handcuffed black man. Stay with us.
Mama, please, I can't breathe. Get these demons off of me. Got the needle on my neck. I'm on the ledge. Baby, come home. Don't feel that dead. Off the leash, Maria begging, don't take my Louise, cold and afraid, hid in a cage, gripping the sky, praying to be saved, just crying,
please, I can't breathe,
Mama Please by Drea Dunur and Rami Nashashibi. Featuring 1200, they dedicated the song to our next guest, Carrie O'Horn. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. A New York court has vindicated a former Buffalo police officer who was fired for stopping a fellow cop from choking a handcuffed black man during an arrest 15 years ago. In 2006, Carrie O'Horn, who is black, saw a white officer repeatedly punching the man in the face before putting him in a chokehold. After Horn heard the man say, I can't breathe, she intervened, grabbing the officer's arm. After the incident, Horn was sanctioned by the Buffalo Police Department, reassigned, then fired in 2008, just months before she was eligible to receive her full pension. Last week, a New York court ruled, making her eligible for back pay and pension benefits. New York State Supreme Court Judge Dennis Ward cited Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in his ruling, writing, the time is always right to do right. Ward also wrote, recent events in the national news, including the death last year in the city of Minneapolis of George Floyd, who died from unreasonable physical force being applied for over 9 minutes, have sparked national outrage over the use of this practice, unquote. The judge continued, one of the issues in all of these cases is the role of other officers at the scene, and particularly their complicity in failing to intervene to save the life of a person to whom such unreasonable physical force is being applied. To her credit, Officer Horn did not merely stand by, but instead sought to intervene despite the penalty she ultimately paid for doing so, the court said. The officer Horn intervened against, Gregory Kitkowski, would later be sentenced to a 4-month term in a federal prison for a 2009 incident in which he assaulted four African-American teenagers in handcuffs. The man Carriel Horn saved from Katkowski's chokehold, Neil Mack, credits her with saving his life. Meanwhile, Carriel Horn has proposed Carriel's law, which would make it the duty of enforcement officers to intervene in cases of brutality. It would protect officers who intervene and punish officers who cover up abuses or falsify reports. Buffalo City Council voted last fall to adopt the legislation, and Horn is calling on state governments and Congress to follow their lead. For more, we go to Buffalo to speak with Carriel Horn. Also with us is Intisar Rab, a Harvard Law School professor who is one of the three attorneys representing Horn. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Carriel Horn, congratulations on winning this victory in court. Take us back to 2006. Where were you when you saw this white officer attacking this handcuffed black man?
I went to the home of Neil Mack at 707 Walden Avenue. And when I went inside of the house, that's when Neil Mack was handcuffed and being punched in the face. So once we got Neil Mack out of the house and went outside, that is when Gregory Kwiatkowski started choking him. And that's when I released the chokehold, and then he punched me in the face.
And what did you do?
Well, I got ready to defend myself, but two officers came between us, and two officers pulled me back. So then I went to the station house, reported it to the chief, and then an internal investigation started, and I became the target.
And you ultimately were fired?
Yes.
How did that affect your life, Carriel Horn? And why is this vindication coming 15 years later?
It affected my life in a lot of ways. Financially, emotionally, physically. You know, I had five children. I mean, I have five children, but they were younger then. And I knew that I did the right thing, so I couldn't understand why they would not do the right thing, meaning the city police department.
So you were fired. The white cop who was assaulting this black man wasn't fired. He, the handcuffed man, says you saved his life. And then the white cop ends up going to jail for assaulting four black teens?
He went to jail for exactly what I had said he did, using unnecessary unlawful force.
I want to bring Intisar Rab into the conversation. How did you get involved with this case? You weren't Carriel Horn's original lawyer.
No, I got a call in summer of this past year in the wake of the killing of George Floyd from Rami Nashashibi, who's the director of the Inner City Muslim Action Network, an organization in Chicago. He's the author, as you mentioned, or the songwriter of the song for Mama Please for Carriel Horn. So he called telling me about the facts of her case, that she had done the right thing, she saved a man. Neil Mack is the George Floyd who lived, but she suffered the consequences of doing something right as if she had done something wrong. She was fired. She needs vindication. And I thought, absolutely, she does. Very soon after that, Ron Sullivan, Neil Eggleston, we all joined in, took the case immediately, and thought that this has to be something where, even if the law says on paper that it's impossible, we're not going to take no for an answer, and we're going to do everything that we can to help bring her justice.
Professor Rab and Attorney Rab, why did this case affect you so deeply?
This case really affected me in two ways. I think it comes—the case itself, our notice of it, and the handing down of the judgment comes in against a backdrop of a widespread epidemic of violent police excessive use of force that has to be curbed, I think, from all sides. The law has to be used as a tool for justice. So I think it's the backdrop of what was and the context of what is today that really demanded that we get involved in Carriel's case and ensure that that her behavior is lauded and that she becomes an example for other police officers, that this courageous judge becomes an example for other courts to correct past wrong.
And what do you think of Cariel's law?
I think the law is one that should spread far and wide so that it will both create a duty to intervene for police officers against fellow officers who are using excessive force unlawfully, as we see happens way too often this week alone. And I think that one of the provisions of the law is that it creates a retroactive cause of action. So when incidents happen, if an incident happened 20 years prior, a person like Cariel Horn, who suffered the consequences, bad consequences of doing the right thing, can still get justice. So I think this is both the law and the case can be exemplary models for other cities and states. There's a saying, save a life. It's as if you've saved all of mankind. The law and the police officers can help be in that position of saving all mankind instead of taking life in the way that Cariel Horn did in saving a life.
But this case does not mean that Cariel Horn gets compensated for the emotional damage that was done to her, being stripped of her job, losing her pension. This is 15 years later. Does she get reparations for that?
And we hope that she will. We took this case as a first step. The law moves slowly, but the first step toward her getting compensation or damages of that sort would be at least to clear her name, clear out the wrongful termination for her actions. And I think she may well go on to determine next steps. Right now, we were focused on getting justice for Cariel Horn in this case.
So, Cariel Horn, has this changed your view of police, both now this vindication and also what happened then? We have a photograph of you standing with Martin Guggiolo, who people might remember, the elder man, the big peace activist in Buffalo, who was pushed down by police officers. They cracked his skull.
What's your question?
Cariel, I was just asking you, does this change your view of the police department and of police in general, what their role is and what you feel should be the direction of police reform?
No, it doesn't change my view of policing, because there's still a lot of work to be done. When you hear stories of Adam Toledo, Dante Wright, and even Corin Nazario, this is what people have been talking about forever. There needs to be an international law. So, I mean, Cariel's law is great that it's been passed in Buffalo. It still needs to be amended to include a national registry, because these officers who are involved in these cases should not be able to leave one department and go to another one so that they can continue to do the same thing. And then the system, I think that, you know, what I did was right. And I think that the judge was awesome in his decision, and that's a start. So if you're changing the system from within, that's a start.
Well, Cariel Horn, I want to thank you so much for being with us and both congratulating you on your actions and for winning this case, as the judge cited Dr. Martin Luther King. Cariel Horn, the Buffalo, New York police officer fired for stopping a fellow cop from choking a handcuffed man during an arrest, sanctioned by the Buffalo Police Department, ultimately fired just months before she was eligible to receive her full pension. Last week, a New York court vindicated her, making her eligible for back pay and pension benefits. And Intisar Rab, attorney and Harvard Law professor, thanks so much. That does it for our show. Democracy Now! Is streaming the closing arguments of the Derek Chauvin case starting at 10 a.m. Eastern today. And check out our website. Democracy Now! Is currently accepting applications for senior news producer to join our team here in New York.